Now that we've talked about airflow and about respiration, or the exchange of gases across the respiratory membrane between the blood and the lungs, there's one more thing I want to talk about, and that is how these gases are carried in the blood, or the transport of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the blood so that they can get from your lungs to your tissues. And let's start by looking first at the transport of oxygen. Now, oxygen, as you may remember, is a nonpolar molecule. That means it doesn't dissolve very well in water. So only about 1.5% of all the oxygen in your blood is dissolved in the plasma, because oxygen doesn't dissolve well in plasma. The rest of the oxygen in your blood, the other 98.5%, is carried bound to hemoglobin. And we talked about hemoglobin back in our very first unit on the circulatory system. Hemoglobin, you may remember, is made up of four polypeptides, four strings of amino acids that all have to work together. Each polypeptide holds one heme group, or one cage made of carbon and nitrogens. Each heme group has an iron atom in the middle, and it's that iron atom that really does the work. The iron atom binds to oxygen. Each iron atom can bind to one molecule of O2. Since each hemoglobin has four polypeptides and four heme groups, each hemoglobin molecule can carry up to four oxygens. Hemoglobin is really effective at binding to oxygen and carrying it around the body. Your blood comes up to your lungs to be oxygenated. When the blood leaves the lungs, the blood leaving the lungs is 97 to 99% saturated with oxygen. That means it's holding almost every oxygen molecule it could possibly hold. So nearly all the hemoglobins are loaded up with all four of their possible oxygens. That highly oxygenated blood then goes down to your tissues, and as we talked about before, the oxygen will diffuse from the blood into the tissues. So by the time the oxygen has unloaded from the hemoglobin and diffused out into the tissues, and the blood has left the tissues, the blood is still about 75% oxygenated. That leftover oxygen in the venous blood is referred to as your venous reserve. And the venous reserve is useful for a couple of reasons. One, having that oxygen already attached to the hemoglobin in your venous blood actually makes it easier for more oxygen to bind to the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin shows something cool called cooperative binding, where if one oxygen is bound to hemoglobin, it causes the hemoglobin to change its shape a little bit so that it's easier to bind the second oxygen. Once the second oxygen is bound, it shifts its shape just a little bit more and makes it even easier for the third oxygen, and finally extremely easy for the fourth oxygen to bind. So, the more oxygen you have attached to hemoglobin already, the easier it is to attach more oxygens. So, the oxygen left in your venous blood, your venous reserve, makes it easier to load on additional oxygen in the lungs. The second big advantage to having that venous reserve is that it provides some extra oxygen in your blood just in case you need it. You actually have enough oxygen in your blood to remain alive for about 4 or 5 minutes without breathing due to that venous reserve. Next, let's take a look at the transport of carbon dioxide in the blood. Carbon dioxide is a little bit more polar than oxygen, so it dissolves a little bit better in your blood, but not much. You can find about 5 to 10% of your carbon dioxide in your blood just dissolved in the plasma. You can also find some carbon dioxide bound to hemoglobin. Hemoglobin can bind to carbon dioxide or to oxygen, although it prefers oxygen. So around about 10 to 20% of your carbon dioxide in your blood is found bound to hemoglobin or to other proteins in the blood. The majority of the carbon dioxide in your blood is found in the form of bicarbonate or carbonic acid. This is a reaction that I really want you to know about that we've talked about a couple of times before, and that is that when we mix carbon dioxide and water, we make carbonic acid, H2CO3. Carbonic acid is an acid because it releases a hydrogen ion. It releases a hydrogen ion, and then we're also left with a bicarbonate ion. All of these components are really important. Remember that having a hydrogen ion is going to be affecting the pH. So it's this mechanism, the way carbon dioxide combines with water to make carbonic acid, that is why the carbon dioxide has such an effect on the pH. Not only is that hydrogen ion important, but the bicarbonate and carbonic acid are also important. Working together, bicarbonate and carbonic acid make up the most important buffer system in your blood. What happens is if your pH is a little bit too high, that means you don't have enough hydrogen ion, then the carbonic acid can break down into H plus and bicarbonate to give you more H plus and lower the pH. On the other hand, if your blood pH is too low, that means you have too much acid, too much H plus, the H plus binds to bicarbonate in your blood to make carbonic acid. So this reaction can go either way to help to regulate the amount of H plus. One last thing about what's going on with carbonic acid, and that is that carbon dioxide will normally combine with water to make carbonic acid. And this doesn't take energy, and it'll happen even without an enzyme. But it happens a lot faster with an enzyme. And our red blood cells contain an enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. And carbonic anhydrase catalyzes this reaction, so the carbon dioxide and water are converted to carbonic acid very quickly in our blood.